Are you lost, dude? I don't know why the PNG person jumps so much. It's kind of funny. Look at it. Look at it jump. Boing. 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 Yeah, I thought this would be fun for this stream. Because then you can make even more "are you lost" jokes. That's also why I was like 2 minutes late to starting stream, was I was setting it up. But where were we? What happened last time? I don't remember. I also don't know how long this is going to be, so we might switch to Tekken or Genshin afterwards. Are you lost, dude? If we get enough emote slots, I really want to make that an emote. Thanks, Fish. Well, the emote would just, oh, beautiful. Someone can send that in chat if you're capable. Have you seen, like, emotes with words? I want "are you lost" and "addux bitch" to be an emote. If we get enough slots. I guess I could change the tier 2 and tier 3 slots, because... yeah, I'd redraw the whole thing, so it's not just the same thing, but, because, okay, wait, if I look at my emotes, the, like, tiered ones... cars, cow, Kool-Aid, some of those are bits, I think. I could very well replace the tier slash bit emotes with "addux bitch" and "are you lost" for the meantime. How do I exit out of this? There it is. Beautiful. I might do that this Saturday. Okay, anyway. Does anyone remember where we were? Because I don't. I feel like we went to Eulogy. I feel like let's catch up with Eulogy a little bit. So we'll go back a chapter so we kind of remember what was going on, I guess. But basically, we're this spaceship. Are we 9 or are we 10? We're 9, aren't we? It's the Pioneer 9. Yeah. And we're up in space talking to Pioneer 10 and Juice. Like the movie. Like the movie 9, dude! The cat. And we are watching humanity gain immortality and just... I am lost, I don't know where we were. We're watching humanity gain immortality and just play football games for all of their life. But, like, football the game changes a lot. The cat's meowing. I don't think you can hear her, but... so let's go to Eulogy. 'Cause that's a fun video to start off with. Oh, Fishy, what's your question? ask your question and then we'll get on with the eulogy. Did my mom just send me? You should go drink some water. I think you should drink some water. I'll drink some water as well. This is my water. Okay, go drink some water, dude. Jeez. Okay, eulogy. Here in remembrance of the Livermore light bulb. It was manufactured in the late 1890s in Shelby, Ohio, and installed in Livermore, California, 1901. In 1976, it was briefly switched off when it was relocated to a fire station in East Avenue. 2013, a mishap again cut its power supply, but it successfully switched back on and remained on until being crushed by a 500-foot ball on July 3rd, 1776. I should slow it down. I forgot about that. What do we usually set it to? It was the oldest functioning electric being in the known universe. It was our dearest ancestor. Why is it doing this? Year over year, century over century, it continued to astonish us. It was, after all, a light bulb that stayed on for more than 15,000 years without burning out or breaking. It was a miracle, and yet it did not occur to us that it could die. Perhaps in a more fearsome age, an age of illness and warfare and cosmic debris, we would not have room in our hearts to care for such a little bulb. We are living in an age without loss. This is a sorrow we have forgotten how to experience. The bulb lived to us, and life deserved to be immortal. It will live on in our memories, where we'll perhaps find more happiness. Oh no. So close. But where it will perhaps find more happiness than it ever did hanging from a ceiling. We love you and we miss you. That was beautiful. What do we do now? I think we should visit an old friend. I think that would be good for us. Eddie? Yep. Wait, he's still in there? Don't tell me he's still in there. Yep. Slowing it down really makes us creepier. I think that's why we stopped, was because the next chapter was getting good. And I like three-part series. Okay, so, a light bulb was broken, and now we're gonna go visit Eddie. Come on. There we go. Okay. Is this Eddie speaking? It doesn't look like Juice's text. I recall when I was small, how I spent my days alone. Bum, bum, bum. The busy world was not for me, so I went and found my own. I would climb the garden wall with a candle in my hand. I'll hide inside a hall of rock and sand. Shit. Aw, come on. Before the fall, when they wrote it on the wall, when their shit, when there wasn't even any Hollywood. Is this singing? Water acquired, nice. They heard the call and they wrote it on the wall. For you and me, we understood. I'm not singing. Hello? Gah! Hello? Hey, someone in there. I heard you singing. I heard you. You're behind those rocks. Hey, listen. I'm not here to bother you. Are you trapped in here or something? I said, are you trapped in here? Are you okay? Okay, well, I'm gonna get help. Just sit tight. I'll be right back. Wait. Yeah? Don't tell anyone I'm here. Please don't tell anyone I'm here. Why not? This really isn't any of your business, just... I'm not in any trouble. I'm in here because I want to be. Please just move it along and don't tell anyone you saw me here. Well, don't worry about that, because I can't see you. Because you won't come out. That's the idea. Well, listen. I'm a part of a project called No Rock Unturned. Do you know what that is? Well, No Rock Unturned is a project made up of people like me who walk all across America and learn about its land and the folks who live in it. Our goal is to eventually count everyone in America as a friend. I was assigned the 38 degree 13 18 line of latitude. Solid. So if you imagine a line that's 100 feet wide and about 2,500 miles long, stretching from coast to coast, you've got the idea. That's my line. I'm hiking all the way through this line, and it's my job to take in all the wonders I see, and try to make friends with everyone I see, and while I'm at it, I... Oh, yeah. I've seen y'all go through here. I've seen people walk through these woods here with that same t-shirt on. Well, you might have mistaken it for someone else. There's only a few hundred of us, so we usually only pass through an area once every 800 years or so. I know that. Well, you couldn't have seen... Yes, I could have. I've been here for 9,313 years. 9,000 years? 913 years. Oh god in heaven, you're Eddie Kraker. What a glorious screen that was. We've got Hey Ya Spinning Fish, just... Oh god in heaven, you're Eddie Kraker, and then where's Ed Kraker? It's beautiful. You have to promise me you won't tell anyone you saw me. Promise me. Well, I mean, if you do, you'll be fucking me over for more than you can imagine. Whatever that's worth, for the love of God, tell nobody. Okay. Not even your people. Not even the No Rock Unturned. Not even them. Okay, you know what? I promise I won't. But if I could ask you something in return? What? See, what I do is, in order to get to know people better, I have these questions I ask everyone I meet. It's on this piece of paper here. Could I at least ask you the first 10? What the fuck for? It's just that I really care a lot about what I do. It means a lot to me to get to know everyone I come across, if I can. I'll tell you what, I've been doing this for a really long time, and I have never run into anyone who was sitting in a cave and wouldn't come out. It'd about kill me if I couldn't at least talk to you. Let's face it, sharing the good news with people can be a little intimidating sometimes. Just remember that it's all in his hands, you're not in control, he is. You're simply a servant dedicated to spreading his word. Philippians 4:8. Whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, then think about such things. Nice. Thanks, fish. The world is full of interesting people who are up to all sorts of interesting things. If you're stuck, here are some sample questions you can use to get to know someone. What is your name? Can you tell me a bit about where we are? What do you do? So true. What do you think you'll be doing tomorrow? Thanks, Audio Jungle. What do you think you'll be doing in 100,000 years? What are some of your favorite hobbies? Do you think we're in a matrix? Do you think we're in heaven? Do you think we're in hell? Do you think we should try to restart the space program? Would you like to know God personally? Audio Jungle. Alright, fine, alright. Thank you so much. Okay, question one is, what is your name? Eddie Kraker. Sorry. Man, I can't believe it's you. Cannot believe it. Already knew that one, so we can skip it. That counts as one. Aw, oh, come on. No free ones. You have 11 left. That's not how that works. Wait, what? geez, alright, you're the boss. Question 2. Can you tell me a bit about where we are? Louisville. Oh, come on. Okay, alright, you're standing next to Beargrass Creek, which... Oh, yeah, it seems like an interesting creek. It's not. I was just trying to say something nice. Do you think you were going to hurt my feelings because you didn't like a nearby creek? Sorry. Sorry for what? I don't know. Sorry. So you're standing, anyway, next to, sorry. So you're standing next to the South Fork of Beargrass Creek, which runs all around Louisville. I'm sitting in what would be called 11 Jones Cave. What was that? What was that? What just happened? What happened for you guys? What just happened? What was that? Did it disconnect? What was that? Interesting. Because all I saw was just a little red box, and then suddenly chat reappeared all at once. Are we good now? Are we good? Hello? That was odd. Where did we leave off? What do your up arrows mean? Oh, up. Oh, this is what you mean. Okay. I didn't know what up please meant, dude. Blue and... Okay. Interesting. Couldn't tell you why, but my bitrate is offline, so that's awesome. Sorry, I'm just making sure everything's correct. Yeah, don't know what happened there. Sorry, I'm trying to figure out what happened. Oh, thanks for the bits. Thanks for the specifically 9 bits. And thank you, Stream Elements, for doing whatever you want all the time. That was odd. I hated that. Okay, should we go back, I guess? Okay. Hopefully that doesn't... That shouldn't split the VOD if it went to the not like this screen. Anyway. I'm gonna turn off my phone Wi-Fi. Okay. So you're just standing next to the South Fork of Beargrass Creek. Yeah, the not like this screen kind of means that it's fine. It didn't fully disconnect because I didn't end stream. It's confusing. So you're standing next to the South Fork of Beargrass Creek, which runs all around Louisville. I'm sitting in what would be called 11 Jones Cave, if anyone remembered it was here, which nobody does. Okay, I'm gonna go off script for question 3. Why is it called 11 Jones Cave? I'll answer that, but before I do, there's something we need to do. Here, come over here. Here? Closer just for a second. Get in the shot. Here? That'll work. Hello, whoever you are. I'm Eddie, and... What was your name? Tim. And this is Tim. And you, the reader, are reading this on a... Oh, I just noticed the lines moved. That's fun. What's a site with a name that sounds like ESPN sports site? ESP... ESP Nation? SP Nation? ESB Nation. And you've been reading on our little conversation here. It's in somewhat poor taste to address you directly, but some things are more important than the fourth wall. Like I was gonna go to a cave. I mean, that would be pretty fun. But some things are more important than the fourth wall. One of those things is your personal safety and well-being. We're about to talk about 11 Jones Cave. This is a cave I live in. But I can only do that because I am unkillable. If you're reading this prior to the year 2026, you are extraordinarily killable. Do not attempt to enter this cave. I say this for 2 reasons. The first of which is that there is a very real risk of you getting stuck in it. The second and more important reason is that this cave harbors extraordinarily high levels of carbon dioxide. Dog disappears. The story of the disappearing dog is another of the cave's claims for distinction. It happened during the 1912 hunting season, yet the memory of it lingers as though it were during the present inning of the sportsman. The hunter sat at the mouth of the cave to drink in the spring. One of his dogs came up behind him and a moment later entered the cave. The hunter waited, called the dog, then waited again. For more than an hour, the hunter sat at the mouth of the cave waiting for the dog, but the animal never reappeared. The story spread alarm among the residents of the section who heard it. I know how people are. Maybe you're telling yourself, well, I'm special. I won't let myself get poisoned by carbon dioxide. You will, and you'll be remembered as the person who died in some crappy cave because you read it in a story you read online about 178th century space probes who watch football all day. Even though the most handsome character in the story completely interrupted everything to explicitly tell you not to. Who are you talking to? Don't worry about it. If you won't answer, that doesn't count as one of my questions. Fair enough. You're still in question 3. Why is it called 11 Jones Cave? Nobody really agrees on the story there. The most boring answer is that it was near a couple of properties owned by guys named Levin and Jones, and the name just kind of morphed out of that. The more fun story is that in the 1800s, there was a gang of bandits known as the 11 Jones Gang. They lived in the cave and built bedrooms out of its little corridors. They installed an iron gate in here to protect all the stolen treasure they stashed here. If you believe all the stories everyone ever told about this cave, there's tons and tons of treasure back here. There's a Confederate sword from the Civil War. There's a cannon for some reason. Is any of that stuff really in there? Pass. What? Nobody ever explained who the 11 Joneses were. Louisville, Sunday morning, April 8th, 1973. We were sure there was booty to be found deep inside the cave. We'd heard tales of dead bodies, stolen stages and lockboxes, and bags of gold. Once we found a glove in one of these rooms, and the boy who found it shrieked that it contained a severed hand. Pass. I pass on that question. Ask another. What? Why won't you tell me? I'm gonna go ahead and call that one question 4. I don't want to tell you because I don't want to deprive you of mystery. Uncertainty is our greatest scarcity. You should be delighted to not know something. Well, I don't agree with that. That's why I'm on this hike, to find out as much as I can about the land and the people who live here. You're an asshole. What? You're an asshole. You have all the time in the world, infinite time, just a little bit of mystery. Ration it. It's my choice to make. It shouldn't matter to you. It's going to matter to your future self. What if it's 50,000 years down the road and you're all out of mysteries? Mystery is an inexhaustible resource. If you depend on that to make you happy, you better start saving it instead of gourding yourself like a little piglet. Know where that'll leave you? You have nothing left to explore in the world, so you'll look up to the stars, waiting for galaxies to collide. You might see it happen every couple million years. The whole time you're waiting, you'll wish for some old forest to discover, some open house to visit. There won't be any. I bet then you'll remember what I told you. Well, what do you do? That's question 5. I play the hits. You know what this is? A video game, I guess? It's Double Dribble, one of the old handheld Konami games. The screen is, you can barely even call it a screen. It's just a printed picture of a basketball court with a few little LCD illustrations that flip on and off in front of it. Way back when it was made, my grandson showed it to me. I've never played a video game in my life. I figured I was too old for any of that business. But I played it and played it. You're this little guy and you have to dribble around the defenders and score. That's the whole game. You get to 99 points, you win. Takes some time to really get the hang of, but not that much time. Tell you the truth, you play it for a couple weeks and you've got it down. You never miss a shot. So I made up this game where I try to beat it as quick as I could. This guy's OG speedrunner? And I try to beat my own record. I got this little timer with me. I'd hit the button with my foot to start it, and as soon as I got to 99, I'd stop it. Speedrunning. And eventually, I realized that it was impossible to beat the game any faster than 3 minutes 18 seconds. For about a year, I tried to beat it faster than 3:18 and just couldn't do it. So I'd see if I could beat it in an exact time, like exactly 5 minutes, or exactly 20 minutes and 7 seconds. Without a timer, it's kind of hard to... You played this for a year? That's question 6. I've been playing it for 285 years. Usually about 8 hours a day, sometimes a lot more. Jeez. This dude does kind of remind me of Zircon, just the way he speaks. It's funny. Ah. What is this image? He's a card. I decided I'd play it for a total 300 years. That's it. Any more than that, and I may as well just stare off in the walls of this cave. I kind of feel that way already some of the time, but I've got to make it last, though. There are other games. There's Shinobi, Jordan vs. Bird, lots of others. There's like 10,000 of them. But I suppose I get 300 years of play out of each of them. That's only 3 million years. Well, that's a lot of time. It's 3 million divided by infinity. Nothing is anything when you're divided by infinity. Why are you in there? Question 7. What is this? Ed Krieger. Ed's whereabouts are unknown. His rushing attempt has now lasted 900, 300, 13 years, 9,000, football card. I'm safely in a long-distance football game between... I thought you were a running back. No, common misconception. The other team's been trying to tackle me so long, a lot of people forgot what position I played. Anyway, it's a long distance. About the Salt Lake Cemetery? No? What are you saying, Dawson? I knew it was gonna be a riddle of some sort. Echo, you're so mean. Also, if you're just joining now, geez, that's a lot of text. We're talking with Ed and I think Tim here. Ed's sitting in a cave playing a game. What were the peanuts up to, Dawson? They were walking in a park? Yep. We're not even at the world's longest joke. We could read the world's longest joke depending when we finish this. Believe it or not, one was assaulted. That's it for Echo, guys. Oh my gosh. Thank you, Stream Elements. You guys are having like a marital dispute, and then Stream Elements is just like, can I have some chalky milk? Bruh. Thanks for the applause. You can have one cookie, Stream Elements. Is there a cookie emote? I don't think so, but... I have one of... Pepe with a little hot chocolate mug. What is that? Oh. That is... I don't really like that emote. I also don't like a lot of the global emotes, but that one... Ugh. That's uncomfortable. Anyway, Ed's gonna talk about football real quick. That's actually a new one that I added, I think, today. Try and guess what the key word that Dawson said that triggers Stream Elements to do that. Try and guess. Okay, you both typed at the same time. It's actually not comedy. It's banger because like if a good song's on, I don't know, I thought it'd be funny. I should really get Stream On to appear on the screen, but I hate the ad thing. I don't want that on my screen. This 5 a.m. Animal Crossing song is a banger. I have like tons like that. Just gotta find them. Okay, maybe not tons, but I am constantly adding if I ever think of anything funny. Yeah, like that. You're so right, Dawson. The Stream Elements doesn't agree with you, though. Sorry, man. Is the Genshin soundtrack on Spotify? There's a playlist. There's actually, yeah, there, okay. There is quite a few Genshin songs on Spotify. Maybe I will add them to this playlist that continues to grow. There's 69 songs in this one. The Jade Moon Upon a Sea of Clouds album. Okay, there's a lot of Genshin albums actually. There it is. Absolute banger. Now there's roaches on my screen. Look at my poor chat box. Oh my gosh. I'm adding Genshin songs. Hold on, everyone. I'm covering him. I'm blocking him. I'm just stalling. Ed Krieger, everybody. Krieger? Krieger? Who knows? This is a good song, to be fair. That's why they're on the screen. So you can see them. Anyway, Ed's gonna explain why he wasn't a running back. Roach, roach, roach. Oh yeah, Stream Elements is only chat. Echo, Echo, how could you? I wish I could move the text so it doesn't block the chat box. That kind of sucks. Bow, 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 bow. Okay. So, Ed was not a running back. Common misconception. The other team's been trying to tackle me so long, a lot of people forgot what position I played. This is the satellite story, hi. Wonderful time to walk in. Sorry, there's roaches everywhere. There's just dancing little roaches everywhere. We're doing great. They distract me so much. A banger of a time. Oh my gosh. I don't think Spieler's here, but Spieler, you did this. You suggested that I add Roach. Anyway. It's a long-distance game between Louisville and Charlotte, so the field's about 330 miles long. Not as long as some of those other games, but the Appalachians are right about minefield. Midfield, not minefield. I did add banger. And it's just a bear going up and down these mountains. Charlotte was whipping our asses. It was 84-14. Thing about long distance games, though, is they come with a ton of paperwork. Rules on top of rules on top of rules. A lot of them are just copied and pasted from other games wholesale. Who the hell knows what's in them? We were around 20 years into this football game before we really went through the rule books and started looking for something we could use. It's about as big as an encyclopedia set. Me and the rest of the folks on defense spent months going through them. Finally, we found one. It must have been a leftover from some old game they forgot to take out. It said, basically, if you get possession of the ball and stay in your end zone for 10,000 years without being tackled, it's an automatic win for you. Game over. And of course, our end zone was defined as the city limits of Louisville. Hi, Lucas. Stream limit. I'm pretty sure there's not.
Women aren't funny.
Thanks, Dawson. Where were we? So one of our cornerbacks, she was like, if there's somewhere we can hide in Louisville, maybe it's worth trying. And I was like, well, think of how many searches Charlotte's going to be able to recruit over the course of 10,000 years. They'll flip the city upside down. There'll be thousands of them. And she was like, well, it's either that or we're losing this game. You want to make a stream omelet? What would that... How would that... What? Like, a cooking stream? Or just like an omelet somewhat related to stream? Are you NBC? I'm probably not. Echo, you are trying. I could potentially do Genshin after we finish this, but I don't know how long this is gonna take, so. We'll see. But also, if I do Genshin, I like to do some of the quests. And a lot of those are talking, but still. Where were we? A few weeks later, they're just about to score on us again. They've got the ball at Mount Washington, so you know, they're knocking on the door. They had this quarterback who can just zip it. Good conditions, he can throw it 700 yards. It's one of the most beautiful thrown footballs I've ever seen with my own two eyes. So he just launches it. That's a fair excuse, Echo. But the wideout I'm covering falls in a construction site. All of a sudden, I'm all alone. Easy pick for me, but instead of trying to run it back, I retreat to Louisville, right? Wow, so... yep, you can probably fill in the rest. When I was a boy, you know, 8, 9, 10, I used to go back here and play. I was like, I bet I'm the only person in the world who ever even remembers that little cave at all. And look at me, I was right! what is this? Yo! Oh, there he is! That is a... I hate that image. You've hid here the entire time? Yes. You know you're famous, right? Like, really, really famous? Nobody's just disappeared in the middle of a game and stayed missing for as long as you have. You're like a legend. A lot of good it does me. I wake up every morning on a rock. It's wet, smells like crap. The nanos clean the carbon dioxide out of the air and bring me food, but the only food they know how to synthesize is granola bars. God bless these little fellas, but they're dumber than hell. So if this is what fame is, you can have it. By the way, that was question 8. The answer is no. I didn't know I was famous, and I barely care. You've 2 questions left. Okay. Does this game really mean so much to you that you're willing to hide in a cave for 10,000 years? Well, the game only barely matters to me at this point. There seems to be a theme here. It's enough to keep me going. It's an objective, you know? It's an objective. You know, I was an old man. I was 87 years old the day we stopped aging, and I was in good health and all that. And I was still waking up every day and telling myself, Eddie, it could be any day now. It could be any day. And I made peace with that. A central theme is something like Thid. And I made peace with that. Having an end, knowing one day would be the last day. It felt correct. It felt comfortable. That's been taken from me. The telomeres? Telomeres in my cells stopped shrinking. My wrinkles faded themselves away. I remember on my 128th birthday, I woke up and it was beautiful and I went out for a run. I hadn't gone out for a run my whole life. It was the best time I ever had. Telomeres. God damn, it was the best morning I ever had. I didn't even have good shoes for it, just my old loafers. Got blisters like you wouldn't believe. Sorry, what was that sentence, Echo? Telomeres. You got a Greg and Rowley Diary of a Wimpy Kid sad edit on your Twitter timeline. From the movie? Okay, what is this? Wait, can I bring this to the screen? Okay, we interrupt this brief story to view a Twitter that Echo has sent.
You broke my hand and you didn't even seem sorry. That broken hand was the best thing that ever happened to you.
What is this?
You know what, Greg?
You're not a good friend.
Whoa. Did face?
I'm a great friend.
I like the part where it crashes and just says the word face. That was really good. Are you crying at this Diary of a Wimpy Kid edit? That's not loading for me. What is this? Why isn't it loading? Okay, we got it. Front lots and I like how they reuse their footage.
You broke my hand.
Okay. Thank you, Echo. Why is your brain is replaced with Sudoku? Sudoku? Where were we? Those are the times. But those times gave way to being afraid. Who wants to live forever? What am I gonna do with forever? And so I figured, you know, I need to get good at living life from second to second. Forget all these big conquests. Live second to second to second to second. One at a time. That's what this cave is for. You're kind of like a monk or something, I guess. Suppose I kind of am. But this cave's even more to me than that. You know, there used to be newspaper articles and things about this cave. Every couple decades, someone would rediscover it and write about it. And people would be like, well, how about it? 11 Jones Cave? A mystery cave right in the middle of this big city? We didn't even know it? And then they'd move on to something else. And then 20 or 30 years later, someone would remember it again. Junior High brought human bones taken from the cave in their 7th grade science teacher? What? I feel like I need more context for what this is. And now nobody does. Even my childhood friends, the ones I used to play with when I was a boy, they've forgotten about the cave we discovered in the way back when. I don't know why you can't do that. Or else they don't care, because I'm sure as hell none of them come to visit. So this is my cave, and I don't mean it like I own it. I mean it like this cave is known only to me. It's my duty to know every little crack, every little place the rock juts out. It's my duty to know when the soil gets saturated and the water's about to come wandering through here. It's my duty to look after the little cave beetles. They don't have eyes, you know. They need a little help sometimes. It's my little speck of the only world I know, and I love it to bits. Well, you got one more question, I think, don't you? Yeah, would you like to know God personally? Ah. Because, see, like, the bridge to God is through the cross. I have a diagram. It kind of shows how, like, how you could cross the bridge of death to find salvation, and here, you can have this one. Oh, okay. Okay, just here, yes, I'll take that. Thank you. Thanks. Great. This is funny. This is a really funny image. It looks like the, you know, the meme? It's like, divorce tears kids apart, and it's like the kid that's falling and the parents are walking away on either side. This is what this looks like. It's really funny. I'm so bad at this. So bad at this. Oh, hey, there's no need to. I'm sorry. Anime profile pic. I know the Lord's up there. I want to let everyone know he's coming, but I just so nervous to tell people. I've been trying all these years, and I always feel stupid, so I get real nervous every time. And the printer prints it weird. It's all blocky and fuzzy when you print it out. There's a Jehovah's Witness in this! How did my football space story turn into this? Sigh. Maybe he is up there. You don't have to be. You don't have to. No, really. I don't believe so, but I've been wrong before. You ever wonder if this is heaven now? You ever wonder if we're all just there now and we don't know it? I've thought about that. All of us have. There's a lot less people who go to church than there used to be, because that's what a lot of people think. But I don't think so. But I think about it. I think, well, I can't be, because I'm like you. I kind of look at the big, long life ahead of me that stretches out forever and disappears, and I get scared, and I think, this can't be heaven if I'm getting scared, right? And I think, maybe I am in heaven, and heaven is scary. I know exactly what you mean. AK cruising, playing in the background. We don't know if they're dead. Oh, but it's video time. Hold on, let me... So they haven't figured out the God question yet. Nope. I sped it up by accident. I sped it up. This isn't slowing down. I sped it up. Wrong one. So they haven't figured out the God question yet. Nope. What do you two think? So these are the space probes talking. No. Maybe. Maybe. 15,000 years of deep space travel through absolute nothing, and you're still a maybe? Yep. Sometimes I wonder if you're really a scientific instrument. Fuck's sake, let's not do this again. Alright. Well, Nine, you can think whatever you want. What do you think? I think so. I think there's a higher power. Oh, you're kidding me! You're kidding me! I'm a failure of a big sister. Well, I mean, nobody can explain why people are living forever, right? Nobody can explain what happened 15,000 years ago. It's a miracle. Well, to be fair, listen, I'm gonna argue against myself here. That's the privilege of saying maybe. Is that a miracle? Yeah, I guess it is. But, so's life in the first place. I'll put it back way further than that. The mere fact anything exists. This got really loud all of a sudden. Jeez. The mere fact that anything exists in the first is a miracle in the first place. Imagine if nothing ever existed in the universe except for a pebble. Yeah, football is different than the satellites. It's surrounded by nothing, and it never does nothing at all. Why? Why does it exist? That is a miracle. And to get from that to chemicals reacting and stars and magnetic fields and whatnot, that's 1,000 miracles piled on top of each other. And to get from that to life that crawls out the water and gets smart enough to make us and blow our little tin can asses out here, that's just being greedy. Loud strings begin playing. So if you ask me, you got lots and lots and lots of homework to do before you can point to immortality as evidence of anything at all. But still, maybe. Hey, can I go out on my own for a little while? Sure. I was wondering when you'd do that. I'm not your parent. You ought to go do what you want. Go call some people. Make some friends down there. I can do that? You sure can, buddy. Okay. You know where you're going? Clearly you do. Where are we going? So yeah, the three that we're talking there are the space probes, and they're watching these people and just kind of zooming in on some conversations. I love when it ends and you just see my favorite worst baseball player. By the same dude. And what year is it? By the same person. Okay. Hello? Hello. Who is this? Well, they call me 9. How'd you get this number? Who gave you this number? 10 gave me the number, 9. Do you know 10? What the hell are you? God, give me the phone, give me the phone. Nancy? Oh my god, Tenny. Hi. Oh my god, hi, how are you? I'm good, I'm good. It's so good to hear your voice. You too, what a nice surprise. So I hate to come and go, but there's someone I want you to meet. 9, say hi. Hi. 9, hi, how are you? I don't know. 9's a little bit... 9's new. Just woke up a couple days ago. Now, 9 hasn't talked to anyone but Juice and I. Not so good at the small talk yet. So this is first contact. Well, how about that? Yes, and we were wondering if 9 could spend a few minutes with you. Well, of course, I was just cooking some breakfast. We saw Nancy a while ago, right? Nancy was... a character we met before? Right? Fantastic, Nance. I'll check in with you later. Thank you so much. You two have fun. Yeah. I remember the name. I don't remember what she did. I think she did football and she caught something. Yeah, the first football player. Okay. Wait. What? Are you just... you're not gonna stay? Oh boy. Okay, you're a little starstruck, huh? Nancy's a very good friend of mine. She's very nice. You'll be fine. Bye! Bye, Missy. Talk to you soon. So not too good with small talk, huh? I guess probably not. But there's no shame in that. It's really tough. It takes a lot of practice. The first thing you do is introduce yourself, so I'll do that. My name is Nancy McGunnell. What's yours? 9? Or I guess my full name is Pioneer 9. So I guess that makes Pioneer 10 your sister. Yeah, when I first woke up, she said she was my little sister. But just a minute ago, she said she was my big sister. How does that make you feel? Hold on, I'm trying to find the word. I was launched in 1968, and she was launched in 1972, so technically I'm older, but she's been awake way longer, and she knows way more, and she's a way better talker than I, so I guess the word... isn't insulted. I guess it's embarrassed? I've never felt embarrassed before. I'm feeling a lot of things for the first time. I built up a ton of residual memory in space, so it's like, I know it, but I haven't thought about it. That must be exciting. I bet it's a little weird, huh? Yeah. Well, don't get too discouraged. You know your sister and your buddy Juice weren't always so hot at communicating either. Thousands of years ago, they made first contact with us, and at first we had no idea it was them, so we have to understand how confusing it was. After an eternity of total silence from the universe, we finally received a clear transmission from somewhere, and we had no idea where it was coming from. Want to know the very first thing they said? What? Fart! Ha! Funny! Is this the first? This is the first communication? Come on, come on, come on. This is the first contact with humanity we were talking about. Far too much responsibility to just throw away on a dumb joke. No, absolutely not. It'll be funny! Do you have any idea how frightened humankind will be? They've probably forgotten we are even out here. They're gonna think we're extraterrestrials or a godlike figure or something. We need to approach this very delicately. They'll be fine. Just say fart. Every day for a year. Just transmit the message fart and never answer them. Well, actually, wait. Do it every day at 4:10. So, like, fartin', 4:10, fartin', get it? You are unbelievable. Come on, it ain't like they don't have it coming. I mean, they drew a dick on you. They drew a picture of a dude butt-ass naked and he's waving like, hi, hi, I got a dick, look at my dick. And they bolted to your ass and blew you into space. This plaque is of significant scientific importance. Lol. Man, they drowned the East Coast and killed Google Reader. Fuck him. Oh man. Oh man. We were frightened down here. It was something I'd never felt before. Kind of amused and terrified at the same time. So I think I know how you feel. I'm happy that you can know how I feel. I do like that the space probes can laugh. It's also a little unsettling. So, you've got me, Nine. What would you like to talk about? You're not busy or anything? Not at the moment. Is your game over? No, not yet. Hold on. Just want to make sure I'm not being tapped. Okay, should be fine. Does the other team spy on you? They try to. Is that legal? Yeah, not very sportsmanlike, but it's legal. A few years back, I got careless. I had the ball, and we were running a misdirection. I had about 200 blockers on that play. I told them to all go southeast to try and draw the defense. And I snuck off and ran northeast all by myself. Spent the night in a hotel on the North Plate. Can they toot? Like a horn, or are you saying can they fart? Either of those is really funny. I called my coach from the hotel phone. Turns out they had it tapped. Next morning, I went out to get breakfast because, you know, this was no fancy hotel. I wasn't in the mood to eat fruit out of a plastic cup. By the time I got back to my room, the ball was gone. From then on, I always used the room safe every time I stayed at a hotel. So that was a fumble? Mm-hmm. They ran it all the way back, too. That was the first score of the game. It's 24-24 now. Nine? You there? Yeah, sorry. I was just looking up your route. I don't understand what you're doing. What is this? Look funny to you? Yeah. Well, a couple days back, I ran into a twister. That allowed me to... Oh, yeah, I saw it. We were watching. Oh, fun. Yes, that twister blew me a few miles north. Good thing, too. Oh, yeah. Because Iowa had me just about totally surrounded. They would have tackled me for sure, and then it'd be back to the grind. You tuned in at about the right time. This game's been real slow in parts. We'll spend a week grinding out a 1 mile drive, then we turn it over on downs, repeat over and over. Getting that sort of open field I've got right now is a real luxury. But more to your point, I'm really just trying to go where they're not. They've got defenders patrolling the end zone, but they're not as concentrated up here. I'm about 8,000 yards from the river now. I'm real close. This afternoon I'll probably make a break for it. It seems weird to me that you'd want to be so close to a town. It's usually my game plan whenever I'm in a cross-country game like this one, especially somewhere like Nebraska. If I'm out in the middle of nowhere, I stick out, right? So someone could spot me from half a mile off. And of course, if I'm in a town, there are lots of eyes and ears on me. And unless it's a real friendly town, word gets around. So I like to stay in the periphery, just outside of town. That's where they forget to look. This is so far from my idea of football. Football's different things to different people. I see this kind of football, the open world kind, as an end state. The old grid football, the 100-yard kind, was basically just training wheels. The game was always all about the field, of course, the ground, the earth, and it was kind of like, here, take this little boring flat grassy rectangle and prove you can really know it and understand it. And they spent hundreds of years getting to know the hell out of it. And now, to me, football is a further exercise in getting to know and love this world, this planet, you know? The actual ground, it's so rich with history, it's just embarrassing. I've been thinking the same thing. You know, I was telling someone just the other day that I can barely walk 10 feet without sticking my foot into some kind of sacred ground where something special happened. Maybe a week ago, maybe 10,000 years ago. You see right over there, a couple hundred yards from where I'm standing? That's where Al Capone's brother lived. You know who Al Capone is? Hold on. Yeah, his brother lived there. He was a prohibition agent for the government. Can you believe that? Good night, spring. Sleep well. Thanks for joining. Is it waving goodbye? Okay. We're back to the roaches. He was a prohibition agent for the government. Can you believe that? All this time, his brother was the most famous bootlegger in America, and here he was, doing the exact opposite. At a war with each other like they were the Greek gods or something. And of course, the town's named after Homer. Can't make that up. It's a funny word. World, not word. So they're not here anymore? Oh, no, no. They passed long before the moment, you know, when people stopped passing on. I was just thinking about people from back then. The people who lived just a little too soon to live forever. It's not fair. It's not. It's really not. Do you ever think about those people? I do. I think about them often. I was almost one of them. Really? Mm-hmm. I was about the last person in the world you'd expect to see in front of you now. Star running back? I was not. A little after my 70th birthday, I got sick. What a photo. It was hard, it was painful. I was starting to think, well, pretty soon's probably gonna be my time. I couldn't get out of the house a whole lot. My daughter would come to visit. He was great, but she could only be there some of the time. So a lot of the time, I just sit in my living room and watch TV. Did they get young again? I was wondering. I started to watch football. I'd kind of grown up with it a little, but to tell you the truth, I hadn't usually been much of a fan. But I got fixed up with a little satellite dish and I'd watch it every Sunday. I watched the Browns a lot. Oh, they're good. You were made in 1968? Yeah. You better check your residual memory. Okay. Oh, wow. I guess the Browns aren't good, is what I'm taking from that. I started watching them because my grandpa was always a big fan. They were bad, they just stunk up the field every week. I think in 2026, they went 3-15, something like that. I loved that about them. Because, you know, I'd flip around all the channels on the satellite box, and all the shows were about people winning, people succeeding, people getting happy endings. And even in sports, you know, even if a team is having a bad year, it's just kind of their turn to be bad. And in a few years, they'd be good again. And I'm sitting on my sofa thinking, a lot of good that does me. I don't know anything about that kind of life. I don't need to see all these stories when I'm sitting in this dusty little house with an oxygen tank. Just don't need it. But the Browns, I know they'd always be there. They'd always lose. I got up every morning, it hurt, and at night I'd go to bed. They'd get up every Sunday, get the tar beat out of them, and they'd show up the next Sunday to do it all again. I loved that. I loved them. I felt like I was one of them. Did they ever win the championship? The Super Bowl? What? Oh yeah. Ha, no, they never did. The miracle that didn't happen for them happened for me. I remember they gave me 3 to 6 months. Well, 3 months passed, then six. And they drive me to the doctors, and the doctor's like, this is not adding up. So they sent me to the hospital in the city. Ran all kinds of tests, and they're like, well, it's happening to you too. And I said, what? And they said, nothing. 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 I was getting better. Not even a few years later. I was all the way back to my old self. Those were wild days for all of us. For everybody, they were wild days. And there's no way to know, of course. But I feel like that team carried me that far. That day was the finish line. I think they helped to carry me there. I've been thinking about what that's like. Not existing, I mean. Well, I guess we'll never know. I do use him quite a bit in Genshin. Oh shoot, my chair just dropped. I have a weird selection of characters. It's either that or have basically all healers or all pyro on a team. And that's not the best, I don't think. I still don't know that much about it to really be like, oh no, I have to use him. So. Yeah, I have two pyro and two, whatever the ice is. Ten and Juice are really broken up about the bulb. I know. I was so sad to hear about it. Truly tragic. It meant a lot to me. I can only imagine what y'all must be going through. Adieu, Chi-Chi. They're more sad about it than me. It's like they're not used to saying goodbye to anything. No, none of us are. Best problem to have, I suppose. I guess so. You know, my grandpa had this big neon sign he always had in the family room. It said, Go Browns, on it in big letters, and had that brown helmet. I think he brought it home for one of his buddies at the bar or something. Couldn't say for sure. Yeah, this story kind of gets a little emotional, dramatic. I'm not emotional, but it definitely is serious. My grandpa thought it looked tacky. I remember grandma thought it looked tacky. I remember she'd always say, "You can turn that thing on after I go to bed." That was the compromise. The night he passed away, I was staying the night. My grandma woke me up in the middle of the night and said a neighbor was coming by to watch me, that grandpa had passed on. They'd already taken him away, and in the middle of everyone running around, there were a few minutes there where I was just there by myself in the family room, and that sign was the only thing on. And it just softly lit up the room in this beautiful sort of orangey brown. I was 8 years old then, and I remember just kind of standing there and looking at the light in the room. And you know what I thought? I remember thinking how strange it was that the light was still on. I thought that, well, if he was gone, then the light he switched on should have turned off. That as soon as he went, everything should go with him. But there it was, though, just glowing. Man. We're nearing the end, aren't we? What is the word I'm trying to find? Is it emotional? I would say dramatic, but it's not like action-y, right? It's melancholy, it is, but that's not the word I'm looking for. Maybe there isn't a word. Anyway. Let me drink some water. Video time. I think we have this and then maybe another one. If I remember correctly.
How did it go?
You were nagging me yesterday for not eating supper until like 9. Oh, commercial. Hold on. I'll wait a minute. You were getting mad at me yesterday for not eating supper, and now it's like 10 p.m. and you're not? I'm gonna give it a minute so anyone that did get an ad doesn't miss this. Okay, I think it's been a minute. I'm not sure though. How'd it go? Good. I think it went good. Nancy told me about the plaque. Oh god, of course she did. So they attached it to you in case extraterrestrials found you? Wait, that's not what Nancy said. I'm confused. Yep. Did you ever see any? Nope. Do you think we ever will? I've been looking real hard for thousands of years, and I have no reason to think so. Ha! 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 Fuck. What? You're a drawing of butt-ass naked people that's hurtling through space. And for no reason. Like, imagine, a million years from now, you reach some far-off galaxy, galley, that's nearing entropy, and, like, nothing ever moves around in it anymore. It's just still for thousands of thousands of years. And then you come on zooming through. Whoosh! Here's a dick. Oh, jeez. Haha. I'm trying to skip it. I don't know how much Twitch likes that. See? 9 likes my joke. I broke it. Did I break it? Is this supposed to happen? I think 9 died. Ah, shit. 9? Buddy? I was trying to skip through it because Twitch doesn't like nudity. Don't freak out. This is normal. You're fine. You just need to recharge. Here, you got one? Yep, I got like 1. Eat up, little buddy. Hey. You lost your charge, that's all. I would have warned you, I just thought your capacity was gonna be a little higher. You've only got a little power left. After that, you're gonna have to charge up for a little while. How long? Hard to say. Probably a few months at least. No, I mean, how much time left on this charge? Oh, I don't know. A few minutes? Listen, it's no big deal. Jason and I had to shut down all the time. I have to see New York. Oh, come on. It can wait. No. Now. I have to see it. Yes, thank you, Stream Elements. So true. Yeah, Stream Elements. Interrupt the most intense part of the story. See, that's exactly what I created the command for. So if you typed banger music, it tried to bargain at first. Like, oh, they're making shit up. Like, well, I won't be alive to have to deal with it. Like, well, who cares? I live in Kansas City. Like, I just worked a double and I'm too tired. Don't bother me with this shit. When it started happening, they kept bargaining. Like, we'll just fix it with science. Like, well, it's too late not to stop it. Like, well, we're gonna melt a little. Nah, man. All of it. Like, all of it. And then all this was gone. I miss it dearly. Heard the bagels were trash, though. .75 speed really doesn't help. Just makes it sadder. Maybe foreboding was the word. Man. Juice be campaigning for better bagels in NYC. Yeah, climate change. I feel like we're getting very close to the end, I'm pretty sure. Hello, you reached Emily. Tie? Hmm? Babe, it was a wrong ball. It was a tie ball. Wait, Ty Detmer? Yep. And he said there was gonna be... Yep. The dealer said, yeah, sure, there's a Coy Detmer autograph ball this guy's grandpa used to have. So I made a dive into Queens, right address and everything. Oh no. Everything was there, like he said it was, but it was a Ty Detmer autograph. Oh no, Jason, oh my god. Fucking figures, it figures! So these are the people who are trying to collect Ty Detmer autographed footballs. Why are they all sad? Why did you recommend this story to me? Why did you recommend me a sad story? Oh, Coy Detmer is what they're trying to find, but it was a Ty Detmer instead. I mean, yeah, I like the story. I would hope the world's longest joke is less sad. Shit, babe, I'm so sorry. Man, image of horse. It's too bad. If only it was a tie game, there'd be a tie game. Yeah. You get it? Get what? Jesus, the joke, I was trying to tell a joke. Oh, tie game? Tie game, you know? God, you are Jasoning out. Sorry. How are you feeling? Kind of relieved, I guess, actually. This game's probably over. This is my shot. Well, you still got 400 years. Man, you know, this could have been a game, like a great game. If Mike hadn't burned up those 17. Man. Because it's like, okay, this is a genius design for a game, and I know we've talked about this a million times. Talked about everything a million times, maybe. But like, it's so rare to be able to drop a game about uncertainty. I mean, how many footballs has Coy Detmer autographed? Nobody really knows. I bet he doesn't even know. So in the process of playing this game, we find out that number. And once we know, we can't really play the same game again. This was special. We can't replay it. You know what it's like? I was just reading about it this morning. It's like a Fermi problem? What's that? It's named after this guy named Fermi, Enrico Fermi. He was the famous mathematician, and he would ask questions like the big one was, how many piano tuners are there in Chicago? Huh? So how do you answer that without actually going and counting, right? You ask a lot of little questions that kind of hack away at the answer. Fermi. Questions like, okay, first off, how many pianos do you think there are in Chicago? And it's like, well, what percentage of people actually own a piano? So you estimate that number of people who, you know, you've been to their house and you know that they have a piano. And then divide that by the total number of people's houses you've been to. I'm gonna say one in, let's just keep it easy, 1 in 100 homes has a piano in it. Sure, we'll use that. And the population of Chicago is like 3 billion. 3 billion? Million. 3 million. You said billion. I swear you said billion. Well, whatever. You know I meant million. So that would mean there are 30,000 pianos in Chicago. There are 3 million people in Chicago, not 3 million homes. You're probably looking at, I don't know, 1 million homes, maybe? That's like 3 people per home. But then you have to think about the number of Chicago homes that could easily accommodate a piano. Probably fewer than usual. There you go, now you're getting the game. Man, where did you read about that? Wikipedia? You rabbit-holing again? Yep. God, I can't believe I didn't know about that until now. Basically describes exactly what I've spent all these years doing. I swear I'll never get to the bottom of Wikipedia. Or at least, it'll take a long time. You know what they started putting in entries for apartment histories? Lori was telling me about it. What do you mean? Like the history of an apartment. Like you can type in 123 whatever street, apartment 3. It'll be this enormous history of everything that's ever happened in that apartment. Ah. I thought it was kind of cool. So how's New York? It's good. I decided to take a swim over to Manhattan. I'm on a rooftop now. Oh, that's a hell of a swim. It is. I'd forgotten. It's easy to think, especially as an out-of-towner, it's easy to think, well, I'll just stop at a skyscraper every so often and catch my breath. But there's a huge chunk of it between downtown and Midtown that's almost entirely below the waterline. There just aren't that many tall buildings. You know, actually, I was thinking I could design a pretty good game here. Really? I mean, I just thought of it today. I haven't really. Tell me. Okay, well, the end zones would be Midtown and Downtown, right? Like, maybe Battery Park and Bryant Park would be 2 end zones. Maybe 20 players to a side, and they got a speedboat. Ooh. So obviously, with all the water in between, in the middle of the field would be some pretty wide open play. But around the end zones, it get all hairy because you basically have to sail around through city blocks. But at the same time, you could kind of use them to take crazy routes to throw off your tacklers. So the blocks would block for you. See? Yes. And also, it fits thematically because New York City grid was literally called a gridiron when they drew it up in the early 1800s. Way before there was even football, so like it's a perfect fit. You always have to get cute. Always. I've got an idea. Yep. Make the ball really heavy. Make it out of lead or something. So if... Hey, how do you tackle somebody? Probably just by ramming your speed rope right into them. They're tackled if they fall in the water. Okay, so if they fumble, the ball's really heavy, so it doesn't float. It sinks to the bottom. So all of a sudden, the game turns into a diving expedition. Ooh, wow. I love it. See? See? That's why you're married to a 386-time TCL Most Valuable Player. There you go. Are the skyscrapers part of the field? Sure, I guess so. I don't think this game would have been as fun back in the day, you know, before this place sunk. It was just a bunch of ground. Way more interesting when there's just no open field. You should write that game. Seriously, you've got a good one. Maybe I will. Although I'd have to drag people out to New York to play it. I don't know how many takers I'd get. Shit, I've told you the computer parts story, right? The what? New York. Computer parts? Not ringing a bell? If you have, I don't remember. Oh god, there's no way I haven't told you. Well, I mean, football wasn't about hurting each other, you just want to get hurt, right? But I don't know. So an old teammate of mine told me this story. I guess back in 2000 or something, he was house-sitting for his uncle. His uncle had this apartment in Tribeca. He worked for the NFL. He didn't know what his uncle did for the NFL exactly, but he made good money. Well, he was in Tribeca, I'd bet so. Right? I know. So at this point, this kid is like 19. When you're 19, obviously it's like the dream of a lifetime to go visit NYC and have some swank-ass place all to himself. Well, yeah, probably. That's probably why they made it so drastic. One of the reasons. Oh, absolutely. So he's there for like a few days. All of a sudden, he gets a call from his uncle. And his uncle is like, listen, you gotta do something for me. You gotta take some stuff that's in my freezer and take it to my office on Park Avenue. And he's like, can't you send someone else to do it? And he's like, no, it's kind of a secret. I kind of fucked something up and I just got busy and never got around to bringing it to the office. And now they're wondering where it is. So you need to meet my buddy there and deliver it to him. I'd have someone else do it if I could, but I'm in a jam or whatever. Okay. So he's like, okay, and he looks in the freezer, and since it's this swanky apartment, he's got a full-size standing freezer. It's not just your regular fridge freezer things. Sure. And he opens it up, and it's full of piss? What? It's full of actual piss. It's full of all these little vials of urine samples. What the fuck? So it turns out that his uncle is an official in charge of collecting urine samples from NFL players. He just kept him at his place? I guess, I don't know. Apparently he was kind of a fuck up or something. He just thought it was just as good as storing them in the office. He just never got around to testing them. So that ends up in him having literally an entire freezer full of NFL piss. Holy shit. So this kid doesn't really know what to do. He gets the huge rolling suitcase he traveled with and he just starts dumping the vials in there. Then he heads to the subway. Gets off at some station in Midtown, and the suitcase is apparently really heavy, because I mean it's filled with liquid. When he's rushing up the subway steps, he can hear the glass rattling around and breaking. So I mean his entire plan is going to hell. Oh man, oh no. And here's on one of those stations where you have to go up like three different sets of stairs. And the last one, he's halfway up, and some guy asks him, hey, you want me to help with that? So he grabs the other end and helps him carry it up. See, New Yorkers always have this bad reputation. I always thought everyone was really cool there. Shush. Okay. So they're halfway up the steps, and this guy asks him, damn, this thing is heavy. What the hell do you have in here anyway? And of course, he's not about to tell him it's full of urine samples, so he just blurts out, computer parts. Computer parts? Yeah. And then so immediately, without a second of hesitation, the guy hits him in the face and runs off with the bag. He told me the sight of him running off with a bag in a hurry just couldn't wait to make off with it. God, that's too good. That is too good. I'm like positive you never told me that one. It's weird to be here. That is really funny. I feel like I've heard stories like that before. Where people just, like, lie about what's in their suitcase and then get it stolen. That would be the worst thing to open a suitcase to. That's so good. I saw this mural today. I was all over the city, just diving and looking at stuff. This big painting on the side of a building. It was all the way below the waterline, a little worn away, but it was still in pretty good shape, considering. What was it? It was just this painting of a mother. I guess it was a mother holding her baby. Never cried underwater before. Oh, he's crying. Babe, are you okay? Yeah. Huh. I don't know if it's gonna come out right. I mean, we got here, you know. We got here. Grew up thinking, one day it'll be our time to go. House sitter taking a dead dog. Yeah, I think that's what I'm thinking of. It was a Tumblr story or something. I grew up thinking, one day it'll be our time to go, and it just never was. It never was. Going under that water is like going back through time. Everything is like it was. All the buildings were built, all the cars were neatly parked. All the garbage cans were bolted to the sidewalk by people who were afraid to die. It was the meticulous craftsmanship of terrified people. We didn't know we'd have each other for good. Back then, there was real fear, real worry. The world was all fucked up. I remember feeling so alone, like I was the only one fighting it. We were all in it together, though. Every stranger you ever met, they were fighting the very same fight you were. Of course, you didn't talk about it with them, but all of us saw that terror. terror any mortal person has. That terror wasn't natural. No other creature in the universe woke up every morning knowing it was guaranteed to die one day. Just us. Nobody should have to live with that. It's too much. It isn't right. No one should have had to bear it. But we did. We all stared it down and kept on going. And we did it together. We were all in it together, like High School Musical. It felt lonely, but we were never alone. We all had each other, no matter how often we forgot it. All of us, we all had each other. Always had each other. That's fun. I love New York street art. I've been to New York, and one of my favorite days was when we got to go around, I think it was Brooklyn, and we just, like, looked at street art. So good. I feel like, yeah. This is the end. This is the last one. So what do you think? You ready for bed? I'm gonna wake up, right? Promise? Promise. Not sure when, but I promise. Okay, yeah, I'm ready. How much time do I have left? Right about a minute, looks like. 1 minute, huh? Okay, I can do this. Should I try and... We're gonna try and do this. No? Well, I'm not gonna... I'm probably make it, like, here, and then I'll breathe again. First, don't worry about anyone dying due to the rising sea levels. Everyone was safely relocated, and I'm happy to report that folks in places like Houston and Louisiana and Savannah were able to preserve their cultures and elsewhere in the country. Second, you may have noticed that Maine's new border was strangely preserved in a straight line. That's because the Canadians, being slightly more forward-thinkers, dispatched aid directly to the state to build a retaining wall. Third, the rest of the world is basically carrying on just fine. While it is tragic that most of the Caribbean was lost, I am relieved to report that to you that they were safely relocated and their cultures remain alive and robust to this day. Fourth, Ten really should have told you at the outset that in the process of establishing our first contact with you, it required lots and lots of waiting. That experience was unfair to you, and due to the very bad oversight on our part, she feels bad about it, and so do I. And we are both sorry. Fifth, no, for the millionth time, we really do not know why humans stopped aging. Sixth, Ten's wording was a little clumsy with regard to people stopped aging. To clarify, babies in the womb in 2026 were indeed born and grew into adults, and all the children grew into adulthood as well. Seventh, I know we didn't really actually look at any people, but thanks to medical technologies, people can easily be whatever age they feel like between the age of 20 and 100-ish. Some people choose to be old, they just like it that way. It's great. Eighth, we're not in some kind of simulation or matrix or whatever, and even if we were, there'd be no way to prove it, and who gives a shit? Ninth, I know your residual data indicates to you that the universe will eventually be ended via heat death. Good news. That's bullshit that we thought was true in the 20th century. Before we had thousands more years to study it, the Earth is going to be always going to be there because 10th, they figured out how to keep the sun going perpetually. 11th, all the old buildings on Earth are still standing because they were built really well and new technologies help keep them in good shape. 12th, that cop in Nebraska was there because he just decided it was his role. There's still some things like petty theft or whatever going on, but these people are the people in the 20th and 21st centuries, and they like the world they built, and they kept these seemingly redundant roles intact because they are who they are. 13th, changing ocean geography aside, state borders remain identical for the same reason. 14th, no, you are never going to die, and neither will we. 15th, time's almost up. I knew I wasn't going to get it in a minute, but... fuck. Well, I got pretty far. Love you guys. Love you too. Love y'all too. I need to make a portion in my data storage. This is the end, right? This is the end of the story? We're always at the end. It's a free play, buddy. Clock's all zeros. It's after the end of the world. Somehow I paused the music. Has not made contact with Earth since 1983. It is almost certainly not operational, but it is very likely to still exist. Pioneer 10 last sent signals to Earth in 2003. is believed to be 10 billion ohms. It's believed to be 10 billion miles from Earth and traveling at only 27,000 miles per hour. ICE, or Jupiter Icy Moons Explorer, is currently being developed by the European Space Agency and is scheduled to launch in 2022. We should have a viewing party when Juice launches, that would be so good. It's the only space shuttle I care about. This is like the ending of The Breakfast Club. Nice. Thank you, John. Graham. Hey, y'all. Next year, we should do a launch party. That'd be fun. I just have to remember. And that's the end. Well, that was cool. That's the end of the story. That is good. My favorite football story. I think there's also a part two. I'm not going to start that today, but there is a part two. My favorite football story that is only football. Exactly. Nothing else happened. It was only football. No space stuff whatsoever. What are you talking about? What's Fool's Company? I just saw Lucas suggested that. Oh, that's the cat playing with the doorstop. Give me a minute. RPG is a role-playing game, isn't it? Sorry, Echo sent the Diver Wimpy Kid edit to the group. That's so fun. What is Fool's Company, though? Oh, thanks, Fishy. Yeah, that makes sense. I guess we'll switch to just chatting for now. We'll switch to this for now. Runs per game. You got me there.